It's like needing some dancing shoes.
Well, I've actually... No. Sorry, I'm wearing my bowling shoes today, not my dancing shoes.
Oh, that's the problem. Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, maybe that's the good part.
Yeah. It helps me stay in the lane. You know what I mean?
Oh! Wait, where's the other... Oh, I'm so late for that.
Oh, boy.
Oh, good morning, gang.
Ooh. Yeah, look at that. Wonderful seeing all the good mornings and the greetings. And actually, it's probably good afternoons for lots of folks, too, based on some of the geographies that we're seeing posted in there. And that's brilliant. Thanks, gang, for joining us this week.
How many of you have a little something extra in your coffee over there? Happy hour, I'm thinking?
Maybe for some folks. Well, you know, it's idiotic o'clock somewhere. Oh, okay. All right. Clearly, we're in bad or dad joke modes here today. We will try to not stop that. Gang, we have Rachel Dillon with us here this week. Rachel, it's your first time joining us.
Whoa! It is. Whoa! I got a really good entrance. Woo.
No kidding. Sorry.
Like, it's like your walk-on music or something.
We rattled.
No kidding.
Rattled the cage.
The band really kicked in there for that. That's brilliant. It works well. Yeah. Rachel, tell us a little bit about yourself for the folks that haven't met you outside of Idiotic yet.
Well, I always start off with the fact that graphic design has been a part of my life for over 25 years. I'm a Badger cheesehead, so I went to the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where I got my undergrad in graphic design and fine art. Of course, I was the one who was told, yeah, you can't quite make it in art, so you might as well be a graphic designer. I'm like, okay, great, thanks. But it has served me very well. And with that, I've been a marketing and PR director, and I've been a webmaster. I think that's my favorite title I ever had was webmaster. Yeah. I was like, I had that on a business card. Hi, Rachel Dillon, webmaster. So, and then, you know, I have been an art teacher. So when my kids were in school, I stepped away from the corporate healthcare system, and I decided, you know what? I really want to be with my kids, but I couldn't hang out and just hang out. So when they were in school, I ended up getting a book published. So a children's book on endangered species, and it's a nonfiction. So I illustrated and wrote it, and a lovely publishing house in Minnesota picked it up. So then I did author illustrator tours and visits to schools. It was so fun. And with little ones. And then I decided, you know, my kids are getting older. It's time for me to go back to the workforce. And that's when I returned. So when I returned, I definitely wanted to reinvent myself. And I was like, you know, I'm no longer just a graphic designer. You know, I've been an art teacher. I've been a marketer. I've always been a teacher of some sort. And so I looked at, you know, how can I expand myself? And I found instructional design. And I was like, wow, you know, mind blown. This is totally me. Like instructional design, where you've got the science of learning, you've got some psychology stuck in there, you've got the visual art and the power of visual design, and you get to share and teach things and help people. So it was perfect. So I went back and got a grad certificate at UC Irvine in instructional design and e-learning. And now, because I'm, you know, a glutton for some people say punishment, I say, yeah, but it's also so worth it. I'm in my master's program at California State University Fullerton in instructional design and technology, and while working full time. So there you go. Nutshell.
That's a long journey. It's a brilliant journey. There's always the power of that phrase webmaster. That always sounded more like it came with an aura, and there's probably some sparks flying from the fingertips kind of a thing or something about that.
Why can't we be like a graphic master, right? Or why not a design master? Like, why was it only the web guys that actually thought that would be a cool tag to put on?
I want to be a design master.
There you go.
That is a title. I need to make that business card.
Yeah, design master does feel like you're now elevating into the status of a spinning chair with a cat.
Yes.
Like you're getting close to that echelon, right? It's, I mean, because clearly that's above webmaster. A webmaster
is, isn't it this one? Yeah.
A webmaster has control of a specific web. The design master is in charge of the design of so many things.
Exactly. Yeah. So many things, including learning.
There we go. Mm-hmm. Before we jump past the introduction section, Lightbulb Joe is asking in the chat, did you have a preferred style for painting or drawing or your own artwork? And I don't think we want to leave that one hanging for too long.
That's such a lovely question. Thank you for asking that. If I'm viewing, if I'm an art viewer, impressionists, that's impressionism is my favorite. I love impressionism. But as far as myself and stylistically, that sets me apart as a different type of artist. I'm an acrylic dot painter. And so I did end up studying, and I did spend time in Australia, and the Aboriginal acrylic dot paintings really was an inspiration for my methodology behind, but I ended up turning it into my own thing, and I painted endangered species instead. So it's kind of like a mosaic. Some people like to point out pointillism, but it's not quite pointillism. It is acrylic paint, but each of the dots are individual and they rarely overlap each other. So it is kind of more like a mosaic where the dots combine to create the form of an animal with variations of color. Mm-hmm. So thank you for asking that, because I rarely get to talk about my art. So
I know Lightbulb Jo has been working and practicing her passion of art for a long time. I watch all of her pictures up on Instagram as she goes through that process. Cool. And her work is beautiful. She does flowers. Am I right, Lightbulb Jo? I see a lot of flowers, I remember.
Yeah.
I think she's branching out.
Exactly.
Leave it alone, man. Leave it alone. anyway, impressionism. So Ottawa, maybe folks do or don't know, but dominKnow, our company, is headquartered in Ottawa, which is also the home of Rich Little. So we grew up with a lot of impressionism culturally.
Wait a minute. Kind of impressionism.
I am not a croc.
Okay, have we gone off the rails yet?
I took my bowling shoes off and we've left the lane. Sorry, guys.
We are out of the lane.
Yeah. Someone is so sweet. They posted my book in there. Aw, thanks, lovely. ML. That was very sweet of you.
Fantastic.
Back on to the rails. What we're going to talk about though is graphic design, because so much of our role does involve visual presentation of information, and many of us come into this world without really a graphic design background. Those who do come from that route have a definite bonus or a definite advantage from that perspective. So we wanted to help folks to maybe bridge that gap in their own and start to understand what they can do and what they can do better and that kind of a thing, eh?
Yeah, it's definitely a great topic, because if you don't come in as a graphic designer, I can see how intimidating it can be. Like, you know how powerful it is because you've seen it, and you're just like, gosh, that works. But how does that work? And why does that work? And it's very intimidating. Like, I got intimidated even starting as instructional design because that wasn't my forte. So it was like, well, how do I write learning objectives? How do I, you know, work with a SME? And it was a very different experience. So the design part, graphic design part was comfortable. The other side was not. And so, you know, merging it all together, I very much empathize and relate to that feeling of I'm not sure what to do. And it's been really fun. Critiquing is a huge part of art. They in art school, they would put your work up on a board and you would rip each other apart. You know,
I remember
and
it
was a part of school, awkward. You know, yeah, and you just get used to it. You just get used to the compliments and the criticisms, and you start to get into your mind where you're not taking it personally. You're thinking, oh, well, that's a different perspective. I hadn't thought about it that way. So, you know, and when you get down into graphic design, what's wonderful is that you get into science. You get into the fact that you're working with some of the subconscious, where people are drawn to something because they're human beings. They're, you know, they feel comfort because that just feels better and they can breathe. And oftentimes they can't even describe why they're uncomfortable.
I was just going to say, you can use the graphic design to make tension too and to really manipulate emotions.
Exactly, kind of fun.
Yeah, power. I always found it interesting, though, that in instructional design programs, it was often mentioned, obviously not part of the curriculum, but often as an aside, I would hear things like, you don't have to worry too much about, you know, graphic design because you'll get a job and there will be a graphic designer that does all of that work for you. And then, of course, we get out into the real world and we realize, where's my graphic designer? They told me was going to be here. and they're like, you're looking at him in the mirror right there.
Yeah. Jump to it. You know, yeah. And it's hard too. Like even going through my certificate, program at UC Irvine and even my program, right now at Fullerton, there aren't any designated full graphic design courses. You get like, a week or an introduction or, you know, you can critique each other, but, you know, here, go watch these videos. And it's not against that. They're focused on instructional design. And of course, the thesis that I'm going to be working on and submitting next year for graduation is going to be about the importance of having at least a year of graphic design under your belt, because it's just another set of tools that helps communicate visually. I mean, visual design is so powerful, and just using some of the principles and really working and honing and training. And it's about practice. I mean, like any art form, graphic design is practice and talking to people and finding out, well, why does this work? Why did these colors not work together? Why is that vibrating? You know, that complementary color thing. Got it. Okay. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
Well, that's a great segue into what are some of the visual design principles that we need to be thinking about as instructional designers, whether we're experienced or just new to doing it. You know, what are some of the basic things that we may see every day and go, ooh, I like that, but I don't know why?
Well, you know, I think one thing that's really important to ask yourself first is, why does it matter? You know, why does it matter that something looks better? I've got all the content there. I've got, you know, everything's accurate. All the words are there on the screen. Whether it's a video or whether it's a slide presentation or whether it's an e-learning, you know, web-based training, it's all there. So why does it matter how it looks? And I think that that's the first step to say, you know, it's more than just a template. And it's more than just pouring stuff in, because I think it's easy to get caught up in the content and forget that presentation part. So there's some elements, and I don't know at what point you want me to share my screen, because I've got
whenever, let's get into this.
Let's do it. So for those of you who are not on a screen platform and are listening, yeah, I can, you know, walk through this, you know, walk through this and opening the door, you know. So and what was fun for me is sometimes people are like, well, you know, can you make a template for me? Can you lay something out for me? And I'm like, could you give me content first and then I'll do it?
Yeah. What do you want me to lay out?
Yeah. So there is something to be said about the fact that having the content makes it much easier to design, and to know what to remove and what to focus on, you know? And so of course you've got a whole fun list here. And, you know, you've got your principles and elements. Your principles are, you know, kind of the contrast, the proximity. It's kind of the scientific part, the alignment, the white space, the consistency. These are all things that tap into our subconscious. Well, all design does. But, you know, it's something that we don't think about quite as much. The color, the fonts, and the images, those are really in our forefront. We think about those things a lot, you know. The other things are just so soft, such soft things, you know, where the contrast. So I randomly pulled this slide up here. You know, the muddled colors of pink and cream and green would be great if you're going to a cupcake factory. but unfortunately, these kinds of almost, you know, I wouldn't say sickly colors, but they're very bland. They're very dull.
There's a paleness to it that
isn't
very appealing, especially that yellow. That's got kind of a,
Yeah, it definitely is not sitting well with me. Mm-hmm. And of course, this is very, you know, content is there. This is very scientific based.
And you got to squeeze it all onto one page. So
you do.
Know, yeah.
you do. You're just like, well, I can't just. And so, you know, I can't leave out the attribute.
This
is
so important.
That's a part of that. But there is a way to work within what you've got to make it easier in the eye, and more importantly, to reduce some of this cognitive load. And the subconscious really dives in here, and it gets distracted. You know, it's like things aren't aligned. You know, they're all over the place, or they're centered here, or they don't match, or you're wondering, why is this icon over on the right-hand side when the content it's supposed to be talking about is on the left? And they're disjointed, they're disconnected. So it's really thinking about, how do things work together? What does your eye do on this slide? And I speak slide just because I know when we do create, you know, web-based training, obviously you're looking at one element at a time. Even in video production, you're really working at a segment at a time. And so you have to think about that. So I'm speaking in terms of slides here. But, you know, one thing that I do like to point out with design is that even when you learn it, it changes, meaning it has a style. And, you know, just like fads and fashion and art and furniture and paint colors in your house and floor, it has a life cycle. And so graphic design changes frequently. And so going out there and looking at design firms' work, you get a really good idea of what's popular. You know, mm-hmm. what kinds of trends? When we keep seeing the same things, remember the little bean people? Yeah.
Yeah.
First of all, don't ever use those unless you're, you know, that's my tip number one. If you're going to take anything away from this tip today, don't use bean people.
No bean people.
There are better choices. But those were a fad because those were available to download really easily to communicate body language, emotion. So people are like, yeah, I'm putting this in here. Right. And then it got overused. So then people started to just kind of look at it and be like, oh, I've seen that before. It doesn't have any impact on me. So obviously, first impression matters with anything you're designing, because we're very judgmental, you know, and not in a bad way. In the sense of design, judging's good. you know, because you're disseminating, you're determining what's important. And that's the wonderful thing about graphic design, is that we have the power to show what's important. If you're going to take anything away from your distracted day, please look at this part, you know, and we have that control and power to say, you can focus on one thing and that's okay. Even if you're going to miss it all, just remember one thing. And so, so I took this slide here, which is a table, and I said, okay, well, what would happen if I just shifted it a little? Same exact content. I've made it into a 16:9 because most screens, most projectors, project in a longer version. So that 4:3 in a PowerPoint format, that's really when our little Macintosh and our little monitors were a little more square-like. And so the 16:9 gives you more space, but it also fits what you're projecting and going on to. So this is the exact same content. As you can see, what I did was I, you know, kind of organized it a little better. Hopefully, when you take a look at this one, you go, oh, okay, there were questions in the examples. You know, there is some consistency. You know, we do have contrast. So you know exactly what I'm talking about. This is the top bar. You've got content in the row below it. And then and below that, I've taken just a slight change in color, so it's not quite so pukey yellow.
So, jump us back to the original one again, and then jump us back to this one.
So here's your first, and then here's the redo.
Ah, yes, okay.
So what it does, what I did when I the biggest thing is you see a lot of white. When you have this much content on a slide, which is, you know, four columns and three rows of content. If I were presenting this slide, I would be talking to it for a while, and I may only show the ontological research row first, and then, you know, and then click to go to the next row. So they're only taking in a little bit of content at a time. But what I noticed in the first design is they really made it a point here, capturing participants' realities, bold, italic, and in parentheses. And I was like, well, obviously this is an important part. So what they're doing here is they're saying, yeah, I know I should make this stand out a little bit. So what I did was I said, oh, okay, why don't I put a little icon next to it? So it really is clear. This is something that matters. Pay attention to this.
And then I noticed right away when you first pulled this slide up that it was, I was kind of asking myself, because I knew you were going to come to this next slide and I hadn't seen it yet. And I thought, okay, I'm just going to just try to clear my head and just see where I go first. And to the graphics was where my eyes went first. And I don't know if anybody else had that experience, but that's where, like, even before the bolded text or anything like that, or the headers, it was the graphics that drew my attention. And now all of a sudden I'm sitting here thinking, I kind of understand why, but at the same time, I still find it interesting.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, we started creating pictograms and icons to tell stories a long time, you know, before, you know, the true
language.
Language, right? So we are constantly interested in signs. You know, you knew at the age of two what a stop sign was before knowing how to read stop. But you could see the shape and the color of the sign and know, oh, that's a stop sign. My mommy stops at that stop sign. And so, you know, we are very comfortable with shapes, and it is a very global language, you know. That's why I look at the Olympics. They describe a sport, you know, with an icon. And you know, just by how they describe it very simplistically, what sport they're talking about. So it is a really beautiful language. And so our eyes are always drawn to one, that's the brightest color on the screen, is the little light bulb. And so, you know, so you've got the contrast in colors. You've got white, you've got green, you've got the yellows. So I'm still kind of in the same, you know, coloration or stylistic approach, because obviously when we're stuck to brand colors, you know, you can't change the brand of a company. You have what you have. so if you look at it, you say, okay, well, the soft colors really are background, right? You have to really make a choice when you use a soft color or a tinted color. You want something to be contrasting. If you can't read the text, if you're putting text on a colored box, make sure you can read it. I was in a presentation yesterday, and someone had a lovely shade of blue and this really light orange. And I'm like, and the text was sitting on a, you know, blue background, and it's a light orange. They didn't realize that it would have been so much more powerful one if it had just been white content, you know, white text on a blue background, because it was a pretty deep blue. But two, those are complementary colors, orange and blue. And if you're putting them on top of each other, no matter what their, you know, tonality is, you're going to get vibration because your eye reacts to those two complements. Or if you're on, you know, if you're colorblind, you might not be able to read it at all. So you got to take all of the, you know, the accessibility and those kinds of things in your mind when you design anything. So we have a lot of power, but we also have a lot of rules we have to follow.
Let's not go too deeply into this, but I would say that when some people are trying to teach themselves graphics and colors, and you hear the word complementary, mm-hmm. I think in some cases that's why people do it, because they're like, oh, these colors complement each other, so of course they should go together, and me putting one on top of the other, that should be what I'm supposed to do, right?
You know, and it's right, because they are really comfortable together. You know, there's a reason why red and green are, you know, colors of the holiday, you know, or, you know, of a popular holiday. You know, that's why, you know, you've got your complements behind you. You've got orange and blue. They're complements. They're supposed to be near each other. They work well together because they're the complete opposites. They're the contrast of each other on the color wheel. And it's just when you overlap them or you get them too close, you know, if they're rubbing up against each other, you know, purple and yellow, you have a little less reaction because they're a slightly muted, you know, color as far as primary and secondary are concerned together. But orange and blue and red and green, they have some powerful fireworks when they're mm-hmm. next to each other or on top of each other. Yeah. But they should be, I mean, they're great together. That's the thing. That's what's interesting about it. So yeah, good point.
I tossed a link into one of our own Domino samples, which is a guide to color theory that one of our graphic Yay. Team members put together. So folks can check that out to learn more about the, you know, the color wheel and all of that. If that's something that you're just starting to grapple with. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, and color is incredibly powerful. It has a lot of emotion to it. Mm-hmm. You know, it can cause you to feel calm. It can cause you, and actually that's a good segue to this one. Mm-hmm. you know, obviously I worked for a hospital system for many years, and I can guarantee that the color green with anything within a hospital is not a good color, because green really reflects, I mean, what happens when you feel sick? Everybody says, oh, she looks a little green. So I would say that would be a really a basic tip. If you're working in a hospital system, try to stay away from green backgrounds, because that's not a very, very healthy, you know, color.
Don't make people feel woozy.
Yeah. You want to
unless you want
people.
To.
Unless you want them to feel sick. You can totally do that. But if you're working with, you know, something like, you know, something calming, something, you know, there are times when you're using mint colors, and spas like to use the color mint, you know, greens and really soft colors. But with healthcare, you know, you want people to feel calm, like, cool blues and grays and real soft colors that, you know, that are soothing, you know. So, but this one was great because I wanted to point out the power of the human connection in visuals. So you can see this is a very common type of layout where people are like, okay, I've got my text, I've got my human picture, and I have a title, and I've got my previous next button. I'm all good. All the content's there. Now, if you have like, you know, 20 slides that look like this, and all the human being on the screen does is do this and points and, you know, and changes this, or they, you know, you're going to lose your learner. You know, you have to have variation in your design for it to stay interesting. No one should be able to guess what's going to be next. Like, she's going to be giving me a thumbs up on the next screen. I can tell, you know. So with this one, I focused on the fact that we, first of all, you know, human beings are constantly connected to where people are looking. You know, so if you have an image of a human and you've got a header that you find is really important on the screen, a title, have the person look at the title, because what you're going to do is you're going to automatically go to the person and then you're going to see, well, where are they looking? Is there a bear? You know, your natural instincts are, you know, oh, what are they looking at? Do I need to be paying attention to that? You know, how many times have you been in a crowd and someone looks? And then all of a sudden, everybody's like, what are they looking at? You know, especially at zoos, you know, obviously we haven't been there for a very long time, or in nature. Like if you see someone stopped looking, you're just like, what are they looking at? Is there a bear? I love bears. So anyway.
Yeah. Bears are
scary things.
Yeah, I bet. In Ottawa, you've got bears.
We have bears. In fact, I live rurally, so we have bears like just walking down the road some days. They're a lovely surprise.
Just like, well,
no, they don't. They're usually trying to get off the road quickly because, you know, their arms are full of picnic baskets. So
of course
they're on the move. They're trying to get away, not get caught, basically, is what it boils down to.
Yeah.
I worked in journalism before embarking upon this instructional design career. And one of the earliest lessons that I was taught as part of that coming in with doing page layout, et cetera, was, you know, if you've got a picture of a person and their eyes are going in a direction, you don't put that on the edge of the page. You don't want their eyes leading off the page, for example. And you want that their eyes leading inside the page to keep people, you know, intrigued by or focused on that. So, and that's just one of those small things that's always kind of stuck with me from that.
Yeah. It's very subtle, but it is, it's important because again, when I looked at this version of the screen, that's exactly what I did. The first thing that popped out at me was her. And then where is she looking? And hitting that title, and the contrast in the title is so much stronger and larger than the rest of the content, I could very easily feel myself going from her to that down through the content.
Yeah. And so I actually was your magician. So you did exactly what I wanted you to do. You know, and
wait a minute, you were the design master.
I was the design master. Yeah. Yoda has nothing on me, right?
Mind blown. Woo!
Yeah. Woo. You know.
Can I? Back to the other one. Let's also talk about the fact that her scrubs match the blue in the back there.
Woo-hoo! I'm so impressed with you for checking that out. Yes, that is the power of the eyedropper.
Yeah,
it's everybody's best friend is the eyedropper.
Is the eyedropper.
Get to know it.
And it is. It's important. I mean, what's wonderful is that usually if you have, you know, if you pick an image and you have the luxury of using whatever colors you get to use in your creation, you can find so many wonderful colors just within one photo, you know, where you can find an entire color palette. You know, if you're like lost and you're like, I don't know what color palette I need to pick for this, you know, learning experience. And I do have, you know, the luxury of choosing my own. Start with a picture that you really like and then pull from that palette. One, you're going to have consistency. because it's based off those colors that are already there in nature. I mean, that's what they do a lot with painting classes, is they say, you know, look at nature, that's your palette. And yeah. and try to recreate what you're seeing outside. You know, obviously we rarely have, you know, pure colors. We have softness, and there's never something just pure color. You've got variations of that color around it. Like say in a flower, you're going to have like 10 different yellows. So use your eyedropper tool to help you make a palette. And I know with this one, you know, this is, it's about the human is guiding the knowledge in this slide. So I made her big. Like I said, you know, let's focus on the fact that she is guiding you to give you information. Then again, I pulled in the pictographs or the pictograms or the icons, whatever you want to use, the whatever term you want to, because it translates quickly. You know, you see a hand underwater, you're going to think wash hands. You know, and that's the power of those. Now, of course, the more detail to the right, it says, you know, 20 seconds. I taught my kids when they were little, you know, to say the alphabet when they wash their hands. And of course, I was the weird mom that would sing the alphabet in French. And not that I speak French, but I always loved, you know, the language. And so I'd sing it in French. And it wasn't until my daughter was a freshman in high school and she took French for the first time. And she goes, Mom, you would never believe this. I know French. When they were going over the alphabet, I knew it. And I'm like, yeah. And she's like, oh my gosh, that's washing my hands. You know? So anyway, a little side note there.
In the questions, Matt M has posted a question that, is the human connection effective if the human character is a graphic instead of a photo?
Yes. In my opinion, I think so.
But not if it's a bean person, though.
No, please, no.
I mean, that's
they don't even have eyes.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm drawing the line there. You know, we connect to human attributes. I mean, being human, that's just naturally can't get it out of us. I would say that, you know, you maybe would have to process it a little bit more, you know, to really see, oh yeah, that is a person, depends on the stylistic effect of them. But really, you know, even if any human, you know, that's looking at something is going to draw our attention to where they're going. But that is a great question. And there's so many different styles of graphics and human representation. You've got human representation that don't have eyes. You have humans that are cartoons. You've got humans, you know, that are, you know, very abstract. So I think that it does talk to the fact that, you know, obviously, as far as consistency is concerned, when you do pick a graphic element or keep it in the same family. So if you have one human that is a cartoon-like human, and then all of a sudden you decide to use different characters that are like three-dimensional and shiny, you're not building that consistency. And consistency is nice for your brain so that it doesn't have to think about, okay, wait, why did they change that? Because they'll see the subtle differences and they'll say, is there a message here? Do I need to pay attention to this differently and why? Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't matter and if it's not important and you're not meaning for it to stand out, then keep within the same family, because graphic design is really about pointing out what's important. And using these kinds of things, if they're distracted because alignment's off, I mean, if I had this this over here, which I just moved an icon away, so it's not in the proximity of the language, of the words, you're going to be like, is there a reason? You know, why is that there? What's the purpose of it being there? And if I have no purpose of it being there, other than I just didn't think to move it over, you know, that's going to be something that taxes the brain.
Yeah. Difference suggests importance or something that we need to pay attention to. But if it's not intentionally different, then that just gets in the way of understanding. Yeah.
Correct.
I'm looking at the time. I think we've got one more to go through. So let's make sure we get into this one. Oh, look at that. Isn't that a beauty?
Wow.
Woo-hoo.
I know. Finding this one. And my favorite thing is that this slide is about design. And I'm like, so truly, and this is a great question, would you trust the knowledge you're going to learn from this? I mean, that's that first impression.
But if you're new, you might look at that and go, oh, yeah, well, maybe that's the way you're supposed to do it.
Please no. You're right. You're right. If you don't know differently, your brain is going to respond to this.
Yeah.
Your brain's going to respond to this and you're going to get overloaded. So you may not even get to bullet point number three because you're like, wow, there is so much going on here. Your brain's going to start detaching. Like, okay, this is too much. I can't process all of it. It is pure cognitive overload. And I'm going to just stop thinking about this for a little bit, you know, because it's too much for your brain to comprehend. And our goal as instructional designers is to really make sure that the content is absorbed. And so using graphic design, elements and principles, you're allowing them to have a better learning experience because their brain's not thinking about, wow, that's just too much going on here. With this one, I focused on the fact that this is all about color and there should be nothing in the background. You know, there's enough going on in the color wheel for you not to have anything else going on in the background. It's the white space in this is a necessary break for your mind. And it's a necessary break for you to say, okay, I've got space around this. I can actually focus on one thing at a time. I'm not focusing on 25 different things, I'm not uncomfortable. And those reactions are really, really normal. And oftentimes without us thinking about it, we're just kind of like, okay, well, that was uncomfortable, but I don't really know why. I wanted to do is kind of wrap a little bit around this because, you know, obviously graphic design doesn't get taught in an hour seminar. It doesn't even get taught in a year. This is something that should be a lifelong process for any instructional designer to look into and not overwhelm themselves with the entity. Take a little bit at a time. You know, the biggest thing I see with new instructional designers is that they pack it all in or they don't give their objects and text enough breathing room. Mm-hmm. And it could be as simple as margins. If you're really uncomfortable keeping your content out of a box, and you can see all of my designs, I didn't put any text in a box. You know, I made sure there was enough contrast between the image and my text for it to be legible. If you decide, you know, I'm not comfortable with that yet, that's okay. You can put it in a box, but just make sure there's enough margin where there's white space around the box before that text. I mean, one of my biggest pet peeves is when I see text like kissing, there's that discomfort where it's all crowded. I mean, oh my gosh, you know, that discomfort actually is something that others feel. So give your objects and your text breathing room. And then showing the learner what's most important and ask yourself that. Does the learner know what the title is? Does the learner know what they really should be getting from this slide? And if it all is handled the same, then they're gonna all treat it the same. So making sure that they know. And if you need to use techniques like some line pointing to something, an arrow, you know, someone's face looking at it, you know, making sure that it is the brightest part of the slide, you know, using contrast. I built for one of my my projects last semester, I built a web-based training on contrast alone and how, you know, using contrast, which is variation. It's not just bright versus dark colors. It's varying the size of something. It's looking at that font hierarchy, where you've got a title that's the biggest and a subtitle that's handled differently, and then the body text that's handled differently and a call out that's handled differently. All of these parts and pieces, look at a magazine and see how they break up their information. And then grid lines are your best friends, you know, so if you can view and constantly, you know, turn your grid lines on and your guides on, make sure things align, right? So if you even have your text slightly off, right, again, your brain is going to wonder why it's there. If it's perfectly aligned with something, whether it's an object or or a title, within the proximity of what's important to it, when you do that, then the brain doesn't take the distraction. It's not going to be distracted. And of course, for all of us, timing matters. So if we do have to put a lot of stuff on a slide, give it to the brain a little bit at a time. You know, we all kind of know that, but it's wonderful to really think, okay, I know I have to have this all there, but so just ease people in. You know, they'll get used to one element and then you ease them in on something else, you know, like you're building something apart, because some people are still like, yeah, I can only do this in 12 slides. Okay. You know, if you've got a slide limit, that's fine. You know, just ease people into the content. Same thing with, you know, when you're building a video learning, you know, ease the content in web-based training, let them control the pace of their content, so that they can see a little bit at a time and process it at their speed. And then the last thing is that consistency part. So if you can, what I like to do frequently now is I like to step back, you know, and say, okay, is there consistency here? You know, are the titles, you know, looking, this is a really, you know, broad step back. You can do that in a lot of different tools where you can step back and kind of look at the storyboard. This gives you an idea of, okay, do I need, you know, did I pick the right photos? Are they in the right family? It really makes you look at the whole picture. And that's something I've had to learn, you know, because mm-hmm. as a graphic designer, I would design one piece.
Yeah.
Right.
You get narrowly focused on the thing that's right in front of you, for sure. Yeah,
right.
The big picture.
And
the
so I would do that.
And fall back. Yeah.
Yeah. I would do that with slides.
You know what's interesting? Kind of an aside, I know we're running out of time, but my daughters liked to show me other people's, especially influencers' Instagrams. So if you want to know about that consistency, if you go find a really, really popular Instagrammer and look at their profile page that has all of their tiles on it, you'll notice that every single picture that they post, it looks exactly the same. It's not the same pose. It's not the same location. It's not the same content, but it's got a similar hue, a similar color vibrance to it. And of course, it's probably filters that do it, but still they do that on purpose, right? So when you look at that main page, you have that very comforting feeling of, oh, this is their style. This is very consistent and it feels good.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's been
and
thought through
identity.
And sure.
Yeah, definitely.
We've had a bunch of questions that we haven't been able to get to, but a lot of them are on things like programs to, no, this has been brilliant. The conversation's been been fabulous. We're going to leave a lot of those questions unanswered because a lot of them are about programs that people could do to study. And I mean, there's lots of folks that lots of things that we can find on the internet quickly about programs to learn better graphic design, etc. But one of the questions that's come up both in the chat and in the questions was about sharing your slides. And are you willing to share those slides from today?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, totally.
Absolutely. So, gang,
there's two ways that we can do that. One of them is that we do summarize up every week's session on the dominKnow blog. So look for that post there and we'll make sure that we'll get those slides from you and we'll provide them there. And also then a box, awesome. Yeah. And then the our dominKnow LinkedIn group too is another way that we can do that. So Brent, I don't know if you've got the URL for that, but we'll also make sure that they're accessible there too.
I will find it, but yes, absolutely. Right. We can continue this conversation there as well. And if you guys have other questions and whatnot, just drop them in there and we'll get answers for you and make sure that we get awesome. Everybody on the same page. Yeah.
And Rachel, while Brent's looking for that, go ahead and toss in your own contact info into the chat if people want to connect with you in other places, in the social media's world or other things. And someone did share a link to your book earlier, but if you've got that handy, toss that in again too. So that's very cool.
I would have to say that based on my whole, life and existence in work, grad school, momminess, I probably stay most active on my website and on LinkedIn.
There you go.
Instagram doesn't really, it's like, oh, look at my cat, because my kids are now at the point where they're just like, Mom, don't take my picture. So, I know my kids are teens and they're just like, yeah, I don't want my picture. Are you going to post that on Instagram? Yeah, that would be a no.
Yeah. Make sure I can approve that before you post it, Mom.
Yeah, they do that. Yes.
So I'm like, I know.
I'm posting my cat. That's it. And places I've been. And of course, I haven't been anywhere for a long time. So.
Awesome. Rachel, this has been a fabulous conversation.
So
the chat,
fun.
As always, has had lots of things going on in it, too. And the folks who join us every week add so much more to this experience. And we're always thankful for that. Gang, let's dance on out of here. We'll see you guys next week.
Absolutely. It's been a good time. Everybody loves graphic design.
Everybody does. I mean, hey, you're not going to go to get a massage by, going into a garage. You go to a nice place. That's what graphic design is. It's a nice place.
It's a nice place.
Nice place for
I was pulling you back.
There we go. Well, I'm having flashbacks to my last massage, which was in a garage for some reason. And I'm thinking, You learn something new every weekend. Bye.
On that, we're out of here. Comes the big ending. Adios.